Hello, and welcome back to my RP1 playthrough on Hard. So, in the last episode, we successfully orbited the first solar-powered satellite. We have to wait 2 weeks before we can get the contract payout for that, but should be fine. So now, we're building another one of these things. And this one is going to go lower, and we're going to put the cosmic ray detector and micrometeorite detector on it. And then hopefully I will never have to see this launch vehicle again. Because my goodness, I'm ashamed to be using. Just check that I configured the experiments correctly. I think I did. Yes, I did. Cool. So I'm going to sim it as well just to make sure that we'll be all right. Let's try 40 degrees. I have a hunch that may be too low, but we'll find out. So far, so good. Left on the core. It's super hard for me to be able to estimate my apogee from this trajectory information. Like once I get down to only about a km sec left, I probably can guess, but right now there's too much left to really know. And we're still pitching down. Fifteen, probably, maybe higher. Yeah, higher. Okay. Oh man. Yeah, way higher than it needed to be. Cool. So, 2.5 minutes to apogee. Hey, Loda, this is gonna be Cosmic Ray Science and Micrometeorite Detection. Basically, because I didn't quite have the booster performance to do the 300 km perigee, I had to separate the science instruments into a second flight with a lower perigee. This may be a low enough perigee, actually. Barely. And based on the delta V involved, I think I want to wait till 1 minute. Or, yeah, we'll go at 1 minute. Okay, so excess velocity of about 400 meters per second. That's going to give us a pretty high apogee. Yes, it is. Eccentricity is good. All right, so I'm going to leave it at that. I'm not going to go any lower. Okay, so this totally is fine. Okay. So we'll build it and we'll fly it. Okay, so we gotta wait. And we'll get good tanks soon. That's good. And let me invest some science points. EDL. That is what we were saving up for. That is going to take a long time to unlock. Okay. Okay, so I'm ahead of historic. Yeah, I will be on track for keeping up with history. This will let us stop with the beehive kick stages. This will give us real engines. I think I want to do it in that order. So, probably going to have to do a bunch of math for this one. And the math is a kick stage with a known delta V, an orbit with a known eccentricity. That means we subtract that delta V, and then try to figure out what the orbital parameters before that would be. And that is the orbit that we'll ask PVG to launch us into. So that's fun. Also, in a little while, I will hopefully be able to complete that contract. That'll give us some cash, but also open up new satellite contracts. let's get this contract completed. That's cool. It's rotating at exactly the right speed that it looks like it's rotating slowly. Wait, what? MET is 14 days. Why are we checking for a stable orbit for 13 more days? You have to sit with this thing for 14 whole days? That's annoying. Okay. Okay, sure. We'll do that. That is such an annoying contract configurator bug. That the state is not that it won't work off screen. Why are we at 0 EC? Oh, I have a sinking suspicion. Right, because we've gone a whole month, which means the sun is... Ugh. The sun is over there. Alright, so... Due to contract configurator... doing that, I'm going to do it this way. There we go. Okay. And there's no more science to be gained from this, I believe. Yeah. Okay. Wait, why is mass spectrometry stopped? That's weird. Comms again, no more data, and it gave us some science. Okay, so I'm just going to arrange safety of this rather than... bothering to keep it around. Okay. Start training. Denise will be the next pilot to go very fast, although they've all gone way faster under rocket power. Let's look. All right, so now it's basically correct. It's basically linear. So we might as well wait the extra 30 days. Which is to say, the next thing will be ready to go. Going to add that to plans in case we have to build it again. And let's warp to dawn. Okay. Here we go. Okay, here we go for reals. Welp, that's a problem. Wait, what happened to the fins? Why am I missing? Something's weird. Like, I realized that I had a failure, but I didn't think I had a failure on fins. Wait, what? Oh, MechJib did the pre-launch failure. Yeah, it would be good if MechJeb did not advance the stage if there was a failure during pre-launch. But I'm confused. It was supposedly dawn, and yet that sun is not on the horizon. Man, we had burnout at like above 1 Pascal. Hello, squirrel. Squirrel, that sizing sounds correct to me in terms of Soyuz. My memory is what we did for Gemini was the same thing. And Mercury, maybe Mercury as well? Where, like, certainly for Gemini, like, they were sized for the normal Gemini mission, but the max amounts were for the duration record mission. Higher than the sim. Oh well. And we're precessing more as well. Quite a bit more. I guess we rolled the dice poorly on variants for these engines. As long as my perigee is above 150 kilometers, I'll be happy. Okay, that's perfectly acceptable. Wait, how do we not have perpetual duration? That's weird. So the transmit cost is what's doing it. Okay, cool. So let's set up some autos. Wait, why is turning it off and turning it on again? Was apparently super effective. That's interesting. Trying to catch it exactly when the I guess that's as good as it gets. Squirrel, the last mission was for Solar. This is just getting science. Okay, that's fine. No idea why it was having issues before, but it seems okay now. The autos are correct. I guess I should have given it a name. Okay, so we unlocked the solids. Oh no, sorry, I switched the nodes around, so we haven't unlocked the solids yet. So, So, look at this. We'll be 100%, we will be using kick motors for that. Also using kick motors for this. Okay, so we have unlocked the repeatable contracts. And we are getting a launch vehicle that will be capable of doing the repeatables. So all this is excellent. And like I probably could have put off flying that mission and saved some money, but I would have put off getting all that science, getting science for probably like 4 or 5 months. I would have lost, I would have not gotten that science for another 5 months, probably. If not more, if not considerably more. How's this going? 95% is close enough. So these things pay reasonably. So that's nice. That'll pay for a bunch of development flights. And the good thing is they have 9 month deadlines. So I have plenty of time for launch failures. Let's go ahead and take one of these. Make sure that Denise is ready to fly. Yes, she is. Let us warp until it is nice and bright. That's pretty good. Let's go. No science, just flying. Here we go. Badger. So, I am carrying a lot of cash. I was saving 160 to pay for making my Thor able. Now I'm over 200, so I can buy a couple points. Yeah, so we've got a lot of thrust. I want to get up to something like 18 kilometers, I guess. Should probably look at the requirements. 500 meters per second. Right to 330. Close enough. This is running a J57. Basically, the exact same J57 that the F100 Super Sabre used, if memory serves. I think I configured it after that, J57. Or maybe Camloss did. I don't remember who did that configuration. Okay. I guess we should. We'll go down to 17 kilometers. Try to speed up a little bit. Here we go. So we need 3 minutes. Okay, pretty sure that's the 3-minute mark. Yes, it was. Okay, so. Let's go home. Let's see if we can do this not on burner. Yeah, dry thrust. Alright. If we can do that, let's see if we can super cruise. Yes, we can. And how? Yeah, that's pretty good. Yeah, this is a very clean airplane. It's also a very light airplane. Kilometers to go. So we've reached our cruising altitude of 40,000 feet. Under 100 kilometers to go. There's the Cape up ahead. you have to manually turn that off, apparently. It's interesting. The rest of it, you don't, but that you do. The throttle control. Oh, that's why we're right. We're heavier than we are when we're a glider, because we still have half our load of kerosene. So that's our ballistic coefficient is higher, and that's why the flaps aren't slowing us down as much. Also, we're producing some residual thrust. Oh, no, actually, according to this, we're not. Our ram drag is almost minus half a kilonewton. Probably should have waited till I was slower than 400 miles an hour to drop the gear, but KSP, you can lower your landing gear at like Mach 2. Here we come. Come on. Well, that's a little tighter than I would have liked, but that's fine. Another 4 days. Okay, is there anything that I can be building? 67 days until that's done. I think I want to. Oh yeah, let's do that. Saved 5 days. So yeah, it pains me to leave the VAB unoccupied, but I don't... really know what else I could do. I guess I could launch one of these. But it would force me to use the hated launch vehicle. And I really don't want to do that. So yeah, I think we'll, I guess we'll just warp a bit. Yeah, I was wondering about doing the 80 kilometer contract, but I don't want to be in the business of rolling the dice with my pellets. So, I will wait until I actually have the S15 cockpit. Save, I'll warp. Excuse me. Probably could actually get away with spending a bit more, but we'll see. We'll see how this all works. But you're not out of electric charge. I'm just going to turn off the warnings. And let it oscillate. Okay. So, let us be about it. Okay, there's a 20-inch science core. How much electric charge is that actually? /3927. That's a little much. Okay, so this is a 12-inch So we did insects for the sounding rockets and early stuff, so I guess we can do birds. I'll do fish, actually. Why not? Let's see, 300, a diameter of 300, so that's, yeah, so it's a 2-foot section. Okay. Over 28 liters. So four of these will give me you go down to 25 even, because it's easy to deal with. Okay. Okay. So, there's that. 100 kilograms. That is more than enough to raise our perigee. Basically, I'm setting this up for a commsat contract, because that's going to be probably the highest delta V. That, so 1653, that is a considerable kick. Get the fairing from this, maybe it will be enough. No, this was not set to shoot. This was set to auto shape. Okay. There are the fairings. Okay, so that fits. So we'll use our high drag fairings. Or I guess these are reasonably low drag fairings. They're not like the super high drag stuff from Thor Abel. Ooh, I forgot that integral tanks have a high price tag. I forgot, and that's bad. That's actually kind of bad, because I think that means I won't have enough money to unlock the engines that I will need. So what I will do instead is use septanks. Oh yeah, it's like 1.4, wasn't it? Yeah, that's an inconvenient diameter. Centaur. Let's see. Oh, that's what those are. Okay. Yeah, if only those were actual Ullrich motors, but they're not. I guess I'll just go with that.
Hey, how goes it?
Hello. So I've discovered that integral tanks have a pretty large cost. Not just tooling cost, but just cost to unlock the part, which I had forgotten about.
Oh, that's annoying.
Yeah, the timing is kind of bad because I had literally just sunk the money into points.
Understandable. Yum. Is that using your part upgrade system?
No, it's...
I think I lost sound.
There we are.
Okay.
Yeah, these are they're the same headphones that I had before I worked on KSP. So they're getting a little long in the tooth. I think Logitech hasn't made them since about then, but they're the most comfortable headphones I've ever owned, so I'm loath to give them up. But the hardware mute is getting finicky, where sometimes it just won't turn on. Which is bad when you have to blow your nose in the middle of a stream.
Okay. Alright, so you're saying it's not using your part upgrade system. To buy integral tanks.
I mean, because they're a separate part here.
Gotcha.
I mean, it used to be, so... I mean, before the tank rework, and my original tank rework, they were different tanks for each tech level. Now it's just different tanks between SEP, Integral, and Balloon. And I wish we could come up with a different name for Integral, because like even the SEP tanks are Integral beyond a certain tech level. It's just Integral with structure.
Yeah, that makes sense. Well, you are looking for weekend work, and it would be nice to have better... better warnings about how much things are going to cost.
Yes, that is true. Oh, that's what I need to do this weekend. I need to fix the fact that the nose node on our tanks is flipped 90 degrees. Oops. Because every time I see it, and every time I forget to poke at the code. Okay, that worked. That's fine. Right. So. How badly do I want to have a series of failures? Badly enough that I will use an AJ10, I think. There really isn't an alternative? I mean, I guess I could get the Gamma and not have an upgrade path? Or I could... Nope, I think that's probably pretty much it. I mean, I guess I could use the XLR11. Especially because it's pump fed. It's super expensive, but it's not actually that much more expensive than an AJ10. It's marginally more expensive. Except the pump-fed version is another 150. So yes, it's literally four times the cost of an AJ10 with its pump-fed, but its specific impulse is quite a bit lower, my goodness.
Yeah, it's only good for a very, very short interim if you're looking on to unlock something even better on the next science node to just not buy the AJ10.
Yeah. But yeah, I mean I could go RDO105, but
it is a very good upper stage.
It is. And crucially, it has a long burn time, which means it's fairly heavy, which means you don't have an insane burnout thrust to weight ratio. Let's see.
And its ISP is better. So.
I mean, yes, that is the main selling point.
Yes.
Um, Yeah, so that's a pretty long burn time. Oh, good, this is starting with 2K data. That's nice. Even with 2K data. Oh no, I think the base reliability doesn't take that into account. Oh, it does. It does. It's just bad. It's just really, really bad. So, the failure chance is probably 25%. That's remarkable. I'd forgotten just how, because in my last career I entirely skipped the 37. Went straight to the 42.
Good reason.
Yes. Yeah, so like the gamma is actually somewhat compelling. I think this is the next tech node. Yeah, it's 58. But this I could use now. Yeah, it's pump fed, but it has a gimbal. Just, yeah, it has a gimbal. It's pump fed, and it's high thrust too. Yeah, that's what I did in my last career because it's just like objectively the right answer. It's also cheap. It's cheaper than the AJ10.
Think you've used AJ10s often enough, you should branch out.
I mean, you remember last time I started with the gamma because it's the
Sure.
right call. And like an RDO 105 would be fairly tempting. It's just I don't have the tech. That's expensive. 35K. AJ10 is cheaper and I already have data for it, but even with data, it's still bad. All right. Like, do I actually want to? Be dealing with. Oh, that's interesting. That's basically exactly the same. Is that even tooled? Yes, it's already tooled. Because it turns out three AJ1027s is about the same as one AJ1037. That's neat. It's pretty funny. Oh, that's what I. Okay, now I remember what I needed to do this weekend was dealing with the. Based on the discussion last night about Prescient, have like coding pressure and support. Such that it doesn't actually consume the pressure and it just renders it unusable. Okay. There, that's turned on. Okay. Oh, avionics. Avionics is good. Alright, I am considerably more tired than I thought I was, so I'm going to have to finish this build tomorrow. So sorry to duck out almost right after you joined up.
No worries, I wasn't going to stay that long either.
Yeah, no, hopefully I will be able to stream in the afternoon or something tomorrow for better East Coast hour compliance.
Cool. Well, I will see you later then.
Great. Have yourself a good one. And thanks to you all for coming by, and I'll catch you all tomorrow. Night.